Let's make it quick for all your good work, because there are a few important sessions which are going to in terms of the lunch and the summing up and the reimbursements. Anyways, welcome back, dosto. Sandeep sir, I've introduced all the time, but we'll try and make as much as possible. Professor Kandadas,
yeah.
All yours.
Really cut short our session. Anyway, we try to utilize our time. Okay.
Mic is not on.
What happened?
You take this one.
Okay.
Just shift a bit.
Just shift a little bit.
So, good afternoon, everyone. Once again to all of you. I think the screen says we have only 53 minutes left, but nevertheless, we'll try to accommodate as much discussion as possible. And hopefully we'll get some concession of another 10 minutes.
No, 40
okay. Minutes okay. Okay, fine. I think that's we have, okay. Yeah. So I think yesterday we had discussed about various operational issues of this year's stations, and today we have very interesting aspects, that is the very profile of the stations. What are the stations, CR stations we have across the country? And we have our four groups. One group which deals with the CR stations of belongs to indigenous and marginalized groups. That was headed by Father Thomas. Then we have stations in the campus that is run by the educational institutions. And that group was led by Pinky Chandran. And then we have the most diverse stations that based on urban areas, that is based on cities, and that group was led by R.T. Jayaman. And the most important aspects, what we have been talking for the last so many years, that whether and how we are going to hand over the real management of the CR stations to the communities. And that transition, in what stage we are, how exactly we have to do that group discussed, and that group was headed by Jayalakshmi Chittu, who is a community media expert. So I hope we'll have fair enough time to discuss few of the points and also have some questions and interaction with the participants. I think all of us understand that though there are these stations, these various stations, these various group of stations have their own uniqueness. In the polyphony of 163 stations, there are a lot of heteroglossia. The language are different, there are different voices, and also they have different challenges. If you talk about the CR station belonging to remote areas, hilly areas, they have a different kind of problem, they have different kind of technical problem, they have different kind of financial problem, and also the problem of their own community. Whereas in the urban community, they have a different kind of population profile altogether. Though it's a compact one, we have advantage one, but you have so many disadvantages of the urban stations also. The urban area stations most of these stations have only 50 or maybe 100, maximum 100 watt state power. But whereas we have full of high-rise buildings, there are a lot of problems regarding transmission. Then apart from that, since urban areas, getting volunteers it's not at all possible. So if at all we need volunteers to come, we need community participation. Sometimes we need to have some money to pay to the volunteers, community volunteers, otherwise they simply cannot come. Thirdly, the urban areas, the very profile of the community is so diverse. We have middle class, we have higher middle class, we have very displaced people, we have slum dwellers, we have students community. So to make a real community ready, you have to program, make your content, you have to really produce your content as per the various tastes of that community. So the campus community has another problem, because as it has been discussed already in the previous session, people have talked about that campus has its own uniqueness of this community. Some people think that the students, teachers, and the employers belonging to a campus, it's a community. Whereas the fringe villages around the university or institution also belong to the community or not. Whereas we have to concentrate on the community, students community, or maybe we have a different community. If that, how to do it that? And what are the challenges we have to in running those stations? Then the real process of transition, how to actually, what in what stage the transition process of the community ownership, the question, question of community ownership. How to do it actually? In the discussion that the group dealt to it, the actual process and how to do it, and what actually, what do you actually mean by handing over the station to the community? So actual process, what do you mean by that? How to do that? And at what stage we are in as of today? So I think all of these things will be, has come out from the report of the our speakers. So I think without losing time, I should immediately start. So I shall start from here, or maybe we will be the last one. Okay, we start from Father Joseph, and that group dealt with the CR station for remote areas and the indigenous community, belonging to indigenous communities. And who was your, I think Bipin was the rapporteur. Okay, in case anything left, you can add it. Okay, you'll have 6 minutes.
Thank you, Professor. In fact, we had 35 participants in our group, and they represented different regions and you know, different parts of the country, so that it was very well represented. And as it's already mentioned, Mr. Bibin Raj was the reporter. See, in fact, the time allotted was 1.5 hours. We got sadly 45 minutes for the discussion. So the findings and conclusions are very, very limited. And they need, some of them really require explanations also. So I would just put it very briefly, our findings, and then maybe in the discussion, some of you, if you need more explanation on that, we can do. So in fact, this topic, as you already have seen, it is issues, challenges, and way forward. What are the issues that we are facing? What are the challenges in rural and tribal or indigenous regions face, and how do we look at way forward? Maybe in the sharing of some people, it has already been shared that how they have encountered and how they have faced a challenge or an issue that faced in the practical field. So I have grouped the findings into two groups, that is issues and challenges, number one, and number two, way forward. So under issues and challenges, one of the things, I mean, I just point by point I say, you know, some of the stations, you know, started the community radio station, and then only the participation of people was thought about. Therefore, very pertinent mention was made that in some place the people were not participating. They thought, whose radio station is it? And then later, when the management or the organization that run the station, when they met people and briefed them, there is increased participation of the people. So the pre-launching activity was comparatively less, it seems. Then another problem that was shared is, see, in rural and tribal regions, the problem faced is that, you know, the area is sparsely populated. So, for example, I come from a district in Kerala where our population density is 382 per square kilometer. Whereas in the rural area, in that one square kilometer, you will have maybe a few lakhs of people. So, and also in the there are certain geographical barriers faced by stations run in rural, hilly regions, tribal regions, etc. Then another problem faced in the rural area is the migrant population. A set of people, a large number of people are there for a while, maybe for 6 months, and then you know, they move out, and then another group comes. So the whole community, the definition of the community itself, you know, they change color, they change, you know, composition and all that. Then in tribal regions, there are many, languages, indigenous languages. So which one do you take up? You know, this is another problem. Then in the way forward and the, how they met the challenge, some people share that they are making use of maybe the language spoken by maximum number of people up to three. In my own case, I have other than regional language Malayalam program, we have broadcast in four regional languages. Regional language in the sense tribal dialect. So then the traveling and transportation is a big problem, because in villages and rural areas, it is the access to transportation facility is very much limited. So people will have to, they cannot think of an evening to come and spend in the radio station, because they may not get any transportation facility. They cannot hire a vehicle to travel back home. So this is a problem. And in fact, even to travel also, they need to spend quite a bit of money from their hands. So this was one of the problems that was faced by almost all the groups. So some sort of, honorarium or, some sort of allowance has to be given. But most of the stations are not able, therefore what happens, they will have to go to the village. They will have to go to the remote village. There also money. They need the transportation, so that adds up to the cost of running the station. Then, of course, those stations which are based in border areas, the problem of language is there. And from Nepal, they have a very powerful station there. And then the ones who are running a station in this part of the country, our country, there is a problem of getting it jammed. Even in Tamil Nadu also, from Sri Lanka, the signals are so strong that the community radio station sound get Then another problem is this shortage of volunteers. That is, you cannot sustain their interest unless they are paid something. That was again and again repeatedly said. And in rural and tribal regions, another important problem that we are facing is also the lack of financial sustainability. Hardly there is any commercial revenue that can be generated that comes to us. And so the problem of involving the community members in program production, especially women's participation, is very, very limited. And then maintenance of equipments and upkeep of equipments is a problem in rural and in tribal regions. And electricity and internet is another problem. So these are some of the problems that we are encountering. And then another interesting thing is, though that is not mentioned there, my own experience is that the people's concept of time and regularity. You know, the tribes and the rural people have a pace of their own. So it's not the type of weather with, okay, now 40 minutes left, okay, 5 seconds left. No, that will not work with them. So therefore, we are facing problem in that area.
That should not influence your discussion also.
I know. So, and then the archiving some of the things. So for example, tribes do have only oral traditions. At least in certain areas, they are only oral traditions. So these traditions also vary from place to place. So which one can we consider as authentic? And this is a problem also faced. And that is equally applicable to local cultural practices. And Then the second part, that is the way forward. These are some of the suggestions also that we look forward. One of the problems that we face is that people don't have radio sets in rural areas, in tribal areas. They do lack radio sets. There are instances and examples where state governments have come forward to distribute radio sets. And that is one way. And even if they can, it is available on mobile. Mobile is always controlled, and it is in the custody of the male members of the family. So women are again, you know, they suffer that disability as well. And another possibility in the way forward, what we have seen is tap government schemes and programs. That's my case. In fact, you know, even today we don't get even 50,000 rupees from the region where we are working as commercial advertisements. But we have managed, in fact, last year I got the sustainability award also. Why? Because we managed to tap government resources from various departments. But the experience of the participants show also that in many places these government departments are not aware of community radio stations at all. Even to some of the points I just mentioned, going to people.
I think answering questions, you can add those points. Right. Okay. So thank you, Father. I think your time period is influenced by the very challenges of your stations. So I think next we'll just go to the opposite direction, that is CR station in the cities. So I request Aarti to present her.
Okay, for a timer so that we can stay within time. Very vibrant session. I would start by saying we need a two-day workshop on CR in the cities, because there's a lot of there are a lot of experiences to share. I think that I could immediately say there was a lot of opportunities for learning. How did you do something really well? Two stations that came up that have exhausted their advertising time and they broadcast 24 hours a day. So I want to really learn from them. So I really, you know, I think there's a lot to learn, and this was 45 minutes was like way too short a time. I think the things that emerged, the most important things that emerged were some of the common characteristics of most city-based CR stations is that they are operating in a media clutter environment. Some have 5 FM stations, some have 15. So it's not as if they're operating, they're not broadcasting in a place where they're the only, or maybe, you know, the second FM station. All the ones with good engagement, it was evident that they have listenership, people are engaged with that community radio station, are multilingual. They're broadcasting in more than one language. They are inclusive. They are bringing in voices of excluded communities, which could be migrants, which could be locals speaking multiple dialects. So there are stations that are broadcasting in 5 languages, some even more, and they're doing it despite the fact that there is a dominant language group in the area. So they're broadcasting in English, Hindi, you know, maybe Garhwali, Punjabi, and to kind of bring in all those communities into the radio station. In a city, one of the things that came up was that music is critical. I don't know, somehow in my own experience, I would say every CR station should have music, but the inputs that came in from the group was that in a city, you cannot have a music station, a CR station that does not broadcast music. It is music that ultimately brought in the listeners. I'm not sure what kind of music they're always referring to. Is it Bollywood music or is it folk music? Or in one case, a station in Chandigarh had a very, I think, an interesting idea where they featured local bands. And that's what they featured on their radio station, which I think in an urban environment is a great idea. Across the board, everybody had a problem with 50 watts because they're not able to cover the whole city. And in a city kind of ecology, people do move to different parts of the city. So. But they're not able to listen. So they're able to travel 10 kilometers to the radio station, but when they go back home, they're not able to listen to their programs, and that affects engagement. So one of the stations suggested that what they have started doing in Hyderabad is that they use webcasting, streaming broadcast, so that at least the volunteers who are coming in, they are able to tell them that you may not be able to listen to the radio station back home, but you can listen to it on streaming broadcast. And that has really helped them, because I think their main audience is an urban audience. My kind of flag on that would be that it's very important to keep in mind that only a certain section of an urban population has access to the internet. Migrant communities, daily wage workers typically do not have smartphones with internet or computers. So it's important to keep in mind that free-to-air FM has a power of its own which the internet does not have. Bringing in local dialects of migrants is, I think, a very important part of many of the stations that were in the group. Connecting communities to government officials, because in cities you have a certain section of the population which has access. You have access to the, you know, DCP in the area, or to the municipal, you know, officials, or to the health officials. But you have a huge section of the population that does not have access to government officials, also because they're not stakeholders in the democratic process. They are not voters. A migrant does not typically have a voter card in a city, and there's a sustained campaign to exclude them from the process, because there are forces at work that don't really want migrants to be in the voting process. So what happens is that their needs are of absolutely no consequence. Their infrastructure doesn't cater to them. They are not counted. They're not counted. They don't exist. So there is, and there's another very interesting thing that many of the stations are doing, is making invisible success stories visible in a city where it's so crowded and it's so easy to get lost. And they're kind of finding local community success stories which never find a space in mainstream media, and making it visible on community radio. Community radio also, its big plus point is it's so non-professional, it's very nimble, you know. And I think that's a very good way of putting it, that because we're not burdened by this whole infrastructure of a commercial station or a public broadcaster, we can be very nimble. A community can just say, please come over, and it may not even be on our schedule, and one reporter will go running out. If somebody says, you know, we are having a Jagran tonight, please send a reporter, typically somebody will go, you know. And I think that is part of the nimbleness of a community radio, which it should be there. One of the things that I wanted to add was that we had very, very diverse cities. It's not something I expected. We had like Bhagalpur, Karur, Lucknow, Hyderabad, Bangalore, you know, those kinds. But we had like Siwan and Nasik, and, you know, like such diverse cities. And there are fishermen. There are city-based radio stations, but they're catering to fishermen or weavers or tannery workers. So I think our notion of what a city is has to expand, and that we are really catering to a group that is very lumpy. And that is something that I really wanted to emphasize, because it came up in one station that was talking about training rural communities to talk on radio in a station which has a mixed audience. It's rural and urban, which is in our case as well. And I think it's very important for stations which are catering to a diverse audience, which I think most stations are, is to not try and even this thing out and keep the lumpiness of community radio. If somebody sounds very rural, let them sound. That's their right to sound rural. And to try and smoothen out the edges is, I think, the worst thing we can possibly do on community radio. And to kind of, it's like, you know, I mean, lumpy peanut butter versus smooth peanut butter. And I think we really have to kind of not do that. And my time is up. Okay. So, but that's where we were at. And I just wanted to say, yeah, just keep that in mind, that cities are not just urban. They're urban, rural, migrants, multiple ages. It's a very lumpy environment. And we need 2 days for this.
So thank you, Arshi. I think it's very interesting. Next is very interesting for me, at least, because the history says that social movements, many social movements, revolution originated in the campus. And still, some of us still believe that revolution can be, and movement can be started from the campus. And whether you like it or not, the community radio movement also originated in the campus. So now let's listen to Pinky and listen to her. What's the challenges and the issues facing by the campus stations?
Just ask if my repertoire had to add anything.
Okay.
That was Vandana.
Vandana, anything left?
I think just to add on to the last point about, okay, you know, let the people sound rural. I think there was also a tendency of trying to say homogenize languages,
yeah,
which I thought came up about what is a perfect language.
Yeah.
I think that was a discussion which came up, that, you know, you need to speak a perfect form of a language, which, as I think Aarti said, that let them speak the language, they speak in the dialect, in the form.
Yeah.
I think just to reinforce
that. That's a carnival.
Thank you, Kandarpa. We had about 32 stations, 32 representatives in our group. and the general feeling was that there is an inherent bias towards campus station in favor of NGO station. People feel that while the policy does not discriminate between an NGO, educational institution and a KVK, there is a feeling that there is this discrimination against campuses, which they feel that because they are not conforming to a particular standard of operating. So that brought about the question of clarity of who is the community. And again, we went back to the policy, which says anybody in our coverage area is community. So why is that? Why is there the need for people to then pull down a campus station for not doing certain things? So that was the gist of it. But basically, in our group, we had a lot of diversity within the group, because within the campus station, we had private university, we had government university, and we had two MIB run part of MIB, that is FTII and Sri Perumbudur. Then we also had private colleges. We also had single building operated campus, whereas a sprawling campus as well. We also had urban, semi-urban and rural. So there was a lot of diversity within the group. And the approach that we took, because we had a very short time, was we looked at mission and governance, management and staff, program, community mobilization, finance. So with the mission and operation, many stations had this thing that somebody suggested the idea, somebody else applied, somebody else signed the GOPA, and then somebody else is deputed to work at the station. So there was not a clear understanding of how did it start, but anyway, over a period of time, people have caught on. With the management and staffing, people had issues of, the management had a lack of understanding of why it was there. Top management kept changing, so the station managers had a different reporting style most of the time. Then there was shortage of staff. Workload was heavy because some of them also double up and were multitasking. So then there was also, if a station manager is doing sufficiently good work, then the top management felt threatened. So because of the popularity of the station manager. Some of the management also felt that they believed in passive content creation. That apart, mobilizing community, because the word community was so contested and there were argument about the whole definition of community, people felt that mobilizing community is a difficult task. Secondly, if you look at students as your community, then students cannot be retained. Students, especially in the urban area, are not interested in working in a community radio. They're not attracted to working in a community radio. Some of them feel it's a social service and has to be a part of it. So there were different issues with that. With finance, there is this, again, there is this bias that educational institutions are rich and can afford a lot of things. But it is, in reality, there are, again, various issues. Some of them have a problem of getting money from the institution to work out on things. For some of them, some of the management, if there is a change, like I said, somebody else has suggested, someone applied, somebody signed. So the someone who signed sometimes might ask, what is in it for us? But they also looked at expenditure. There is issues with expenditure, and if they applied for funding, then people asked for a separate radio bank account, which many of the stations had a clubbed bank account with the university per se. So there were a lot of issues in regards to money. Some stations also went on to say that when we have volunteers at the station, the management is happy to invest in tea, coffee, travel, this, that, and all that. We had a long debate about security, about access to the community. How do we go about that? Because access was an important question that was debated, which I'll come back to the solution in the recommendation. So there were quite a lot of problems. But in conclusion, what the group decided was that a one-size-fits-all approach is inappropriate. No two stations can be compared, because all the stations have a different set of problem. They operate in a different condition. So you can't justify saying a simple model for station will suit every circumstances. It's an unrealistic dream. The second thing is the contextual factors within the set of stations always are different, and the stations don't want to be catalogued. They don't want to be excluded on the basis that they fail to measure up to a particular standard. What they request for is more capacity building at different levels. At the management level, which some said it could be unrealistic, but it is important to look at some kind of a sensitization. at a different level. So that means that we need more meetings to come together to discuss these issues. And I also had Mr. Sanjay Mishra in our group, and he summed it up very well, saying that since the problems are different for each station, like I give the categories, so you can't look at a single solution for everyone. So for an FTII or a Sri Perumbudur, the solution is a little different as opposed to, say, Zakir station or Preeti station. So we have to look at local solutions in an innovative way to solve it. But there are some policy recommendations which they have looked at, which says campus stations also need to have an option to place the transmitter outside the campus. Simply for, like with agriculture institutions, for extension activities, it's important. If you have a large campus, then it's only within that thing. The certificate, okay, the other thing was that when you're giving licenses to new applicants, it could be NGO, it could be educational institution, it is very important to ask them for a clear-cut vision statement. Everybody should have read the policy. There has to be that debate going on, and only then let them go ahead with the application. Otherwise, it will be in the situation that we are in right now. And last but not the least, there was a request that when you come for a CR Sammelan, next year we will need more time to discuss campus run issues. But clearly we go back with this, that we are our best judge, and the policy does not say that, you know, community is defined as anybody within the coverage area, and they need a certificate of participation which will then help them with the when they go back to their homes. So that's about it.
Thank you, Pinky.
Preeti,
anything to add? Okay, so thank you very much. I think we have already heard three speakers. We started CR in remote tribal areas, cities, and also in the campuses. Hand over that station to the communities. Otherwise, those revolutions and social movements, which degenerated only because it could not be handed over to the masses, the community radio movement will be degenerated, actually, which we cannot afford. So let us listen to Jaya and what has been a discussion, how and what stage, how we are going to do that, and what are the suggestions, what's the feeling of our participants. So Jaya.
If you may permit, I'll go and...
Yeah.
Please. पता नहीं उसे नहीं किया था प्रेजेंटेशंस में था यहाँ से चौथा यहाँ से So in our group we had about a floating population of 25 to 30 participants. Some people came in and went. But we had stations represented by almost all the region. So it was quite a good mix of agriculture stations run by educational institutions, and as well as community-led stations. So it was a good mix that we had as participants. And one of the initial things that we talked about was what people understand and conceptualize as handing over to community. So, I mean, just to get an initial thoughts, and a few examples emerged, and what we have done is actually we had a few questions which we pointed out, and we just let the deliberations move on. So the first example came up that the licensee is Keystone Foundation, and Kotagiri has initiated a community radio station that is run, managed, administered by the community representatives who handle everything, including finances. So it's just about a year old. We also had two examples of organizations that had initially been licensed to an organization, and they have already formed an exclusive community-based organization, which is functionally managing the affairs of the community radio station, although legally they are still, the original organization is a licensee. So that's a set of examples that emerged. So we there was a query that came up for which we did not have a quite clear answer. That was, if the parent organization, for example, if it is a grantee, then what happens if the administration has accountability is still with the parent organization? How do we decentralize funds that actually come? So there were different suggestions. That ownership question is not only about ownership from a legal point of view. Ownership is really about the entire affairs of the operations and management of the community radio station. So the debate then went on to identify who the key stakeholders are. And there were different examples shared in this also, that the licensee itself views the community as either the area in which they are operating, or the community with whom they have been working, or students in some cases, or specific groups as in farmer or agriculture-based stations. So what about those who are not interested in radio? Those who have been actively engaged, definitely they are stakeholders, but what if there are community members who are not interested in the radio? Do they perceive? And then that discussion opened up an opportunity for people to articulate who their stakeholders were, and that there were local government officials, local functionaries, other partners, other NGOs who are functioning in the area. So slowly there was a little crystallization of who the stakeholders are, and therefore how the engagement will be. That it is an evolutionary process, that when people start the radio station, they probably are not so clear about how to handle this. Mostly they start as a projectized mode or a need to establish a station mode. But as they evolve and as they gain in experience, they realize that it's a completely different ballgame, and the engagement process is different, the ownership issues are different, the management issues are different. And there were experiences shared about how radio stations had the freedom to form the management committee and to run and operate the stations, yet there may have been opportunities offered by the parent NGO, and there was nothing but the excitement of, okay, we are getting funds, so we will reprioritize. So there have been situations like that. On a question of whether the boards were very independent to decide, yes, we will do this program or we will not do this program, if an NGO, the parent organization, came up with a proposal. There were many inputs on where this effective ownership is. And effective ownership, people felt that finance department, for example, was not always decentralized. The finance department still vested with the parent NGO. Sometimes the decisions about finances were being taken by the management committee of a CR station, and in some cases by subcommittees within the parent organization with representative members from the CR station. So there were different models of the financial affairs of the CR station. We did not talk about the separate bank account question. In fact, that by this time we already felt we were running short of time. So we didn't really quite go into it. Whether there was a CR board or management committee, the entire participant group said yes, they did have, and that they were fairly independent, including educational institutions and members from KVKs present. What is the composition of your board, there was a mixed reaction. There were representatives mixed between communities and the parent organization, and in some cases completely community membership, and in other cases primarily the management team putting together a committee. Are there processes, to the question, are there processes to encourage community members to take charge of various responsibilities, which we felt was a reflection of effective ownership? And this included engagement in programming, in decision making, in editing, in day-to-day planning, in documentation, in financial management. So we just tried to put these as pointers, and the major response was that pragmatism works, you know, and it is a process. It's a process with diverse experiences on the ground that everybody is not so ready, but there are some who are just 1 year old and already ready. So it's a diverse group of experiences that we saw. Depends on how much importance the CR project itself, as they visualize, is to the activities of an NGO. For example, if an NGO sets up a CR station primarily to further its own agenda, then probably it is not clearly having the community ownership issue in its mind when it sets up the radio station. So it might be a good idea to reflect on this early on. Most stations said that they learnt it on the go as they experienced, and this process was an ongoing one with different levels of handing over the responsibilities of management and operations. Are there any CR stations ready to hand over? There were many questions about, if we really look at the conceptual perfect situation, then we should be ready to hand over to the community without any legal, preconditions. So that would be the real handover. But then there is a legality involved. So the question whether in a transitional process, if the two models that we heard about, two examples, Namadhwani and Lalit Lokwani, which have formed an organization represented by community members specifically for the purposes of CR, should that be the transitional model? So there were two, three, different views. So there was not a clear consensus, but they said that if there was a possibility, then the handover process may come after a period of time. So I'll stop here.
Thank you. I think we have already only 12 minutes left. I do not want to eat up any of your time. So let's directly open for discussion. Okay. Start from here. Ram.
Just two quick things. I think listening from the presentations for the rural and marginalized and indigenous communities as well as the urban ones, I think a fairly urgent policy decision is needed to be taken. And I think the policy needs to acknowledge and distinguish between two very important factors. One is terrain of the applicant, and the other is population density. And I think the principle involved here is that higher the density, the lower the transmission power, and vice versa. And terrain, can we please think of, for challenging hilly terrains, can we please think of recognizing community AM? I think FM is a line of sight technology. It does not work for sparsely populated hilly terrain. So we must try and think of AM. The other thing is that, just a comment for Aarti's presentation. I think what has happened is that due to the head start taken by educational institutions in 2003 and 2004, most urban areas are dominated by educational institutions. And Delhi is a prime example. There are 6 community radio stations in Delhi. All of them are educational institutions. So if you're talking of media diversity, diversity in ownership is an equally key part. So how can we create space for diversity in ownership within the community radio sector, especially in urban areas, is something the policy really needs to think of. And the last one, I think there's much more discussion needed on Jaya's presentation. I don't think it's really possible effectively to really get old licensees to shift to a new regime. I think we'll have to think of other things like creating new categories or something like that. I just don't think it's practical to do this.
Thank you, Ram. Here.
Yeah, I would like to suggest for the campus radio, I think there should be a policy change or there should be some development at the time of application, applying CR license. There should be a participation or representative from the community for forming this CR radio stations. And these community should be from different parts of the areas, the expecting areas. And I would like to ask one question also. Is there, after overhanding the CR to the community, who is going to take the responsibility? And is there any chances that one particular, it will go into a particular hand or maybe in a party, like a cooperative cooperative institutes?
Okay, yeah. Thank you. So, Jahid, please introduce yourself.
This is Zahid from the Canadian Hyderabad. इतने साल हो गए, मैं अभी तक ये समझ नहीं पाया हूँ कि कम्युनिटी डिफाइन कैसा कर रहे हैं आप लोग. कम्युनिटी है क्या? अगर कोई धोती कुर्ता या पहन के आ जाए तो वो कम्युनिटी बोलेंगे, या आपके एरिया में जो कम्युनिटीज रहते हैं, जो एरिया वाइज आप डिसाइड करेंगे? अगर आप एरिया वाइज डिसाइड करेंगे तो क्या ओनर एक कम्युनिटी नहीं है? कम्युनिटी मेंबर नहीं है ओनर? अगर ओनर भी कम्युनिटी मेंबर नहीं है, आप दूसरे आप कम्युनिटीज को, अदर कम्युनिटीज को ओनरशिप दे रहे हैं, तो देन अगेन दे बिकेम ओनर, तो क्या वो कम्युनिटी के होंगे? ये मैं कंफ्यूजन है इसलिए.
थैंक यू. नेक्स्ट वेनू. उसके बाद आप विल कम योर टर्न कर. या ओके, कृपा शंकर जी.
मेरा बस छोटा सा आदरणीय आरजी जी से प्रश्न है. आपने अपने प्रवचन में बताया था आपने अपने बातों में बताया था कि शहर के लोग जो है सभी सरकारी अधिकारी के पास नहीं पहुंच पाते हैं, एक बात बताया था. मैं जहां तक जानता हूं शहर में जो है नगर पंचायत है, वार्ड है, हर जगह सरकारी कर्मचारी लगे हुए हैं लोगों का सेवा करने के लिए, लोगों का बात सुनने के लिए. और जहां तक बिहार का परिप्रेक्ष्य है, वहां पर जो है प्रखंड स्तर पर, अनुमंडल स्तर पर, जिला स्तर पर, परमंडल स्तर पर सप्ताह में एक दिन निश्चित किया गया है कोई भी व्यक्ति जो है अधिकारी से मिले.
तो
दूसरा एक खत्म हो रहा है बस. आपने 30 मिनट बोला, हम शांति से सुने.
जल्दी
हम रेडियो का प्रसारण करते हैं तो इसमें आपने कहीं भी प्रोत्साहन कार्यक्रमों का चर्चा नहीं किया. जैसे हम लोगों को अंग्रेजी में बोले तो मोटिवेट करके प्रोत्साहित करते हैं, जाड़ा के दिनों में गरीबों के बीच में कंबल बंटवाते हैं और रेडियो स्टेशन के माध्यम से बताते हैं कि गरीबों के बीच में यह व्यक्ति जो है 50 कंबल बांटे. बस दो. और जो है आदरणीय रूपमणि जी,
कृपा शंकर जी,
एक क्वेश्चन जल्दी से ऑडिट का कहीं भी चर्चा नहीं हुआ कि एनजीओ जो है कम्युनिटी रेडियो स्टेशन का ऑडिट कराएगा नहीं कराएगा, इन्होंने पूरा अपने ब्रीफ में कहीं नहीं चर्चा किया. हम चाहते हैं कि ऑडिट पर भी फोकस होना चाहिए. थैंक यू.
ओके वेनू प्लीज. आई हैव नोटेड डाउन.
It was very interesting to hear from the tribal communities group that there was discussion around whether it was a problem that the tribal communities had no sense of time or regularity, and that it was a problem that to figure out which cultural practices are authentic. So it was interesting for me to hear this, and I'm just wondering, and this connects to the discussion that happened in the ownership transfer also. I'm just wondering whether the social and economic hierarchies that exist to question which we were setting up CR stations, whether the CR stations in their operations are not then duplicating the same hierarchies in your operations. So that's the point.
Thank you. Sanjay Mishra.
Thank you very much. I think the point is already being highlighted.
Institutions, NGOs, it's not going to happen. They are not going to transfer legal ownership
of the community. Community is not homogeneous and is very, as was pointed out, very vertical. Now, community radio should be the opposite, anti-vertical.
From every campus, at least maybe three or four people from each level of the operations, whether it's vice chancellor downwards to the headquarters, should come in. When it comes to cities, I don't know how to answer Kripa Shankar ji. I would only say that in my own experience, just holding a mic gives you access. Having a Gurgaon ki awaaz label in front of me gives me access to a government office or a government official. I have the power to ask why is this road broken, why is it not being filled. And a rickshaw puller in Gurgaon or a daily wage worker does not have the access to ask those questions. And I think the stations who are using community radio to connect, and they're using mobiles most often, to connect communities to government officials, to government departments, I think they're really bridging a big, big gap that exists. So, maybe in your area people are able to access. At my own experience, there are huge gaps, and I think the radio stations have a huge role to play in bridging those gaps.
Thank you. The fact that there were more than 23 questions after this group work presentation shows two things to me. One, that we just get warmed up in the last workshop sessions and we don't find the 45 minutes given sufficient. It just triggers a lot of discussion. There are still a lot of questions that are still open. Need more space and time for further deliberation. That we go away feeling energized, but we still don't know all the answers. So I'm not even going to attempt responding to any of these questions, but to say that this is always an enriching process and we should try and find some online means to keep the communication on, to further these deliberations at least. This is what I felt. So I'll stop here.
So thank you very much. I think we should also keep something for the next summit to build it. So thank you, Father. Thank you, Pinky. Thank you, Arti, and thank you, Jaya. And also thank you, all of you, for your cooperation in conducting this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tanarva, and all our panelists. The sessions that we have had for the last 2.5 days. Yeah, request everyone. इसके लिए समय है, maybe 2-3 साल या हो जाए. शुक्रिया मैम. Now please take over.
There is a long list of thank yous, and I was thinking that, you know, it's always a very difficult job to say. So what shall we do? Shall we say thank you everybody?
Yes.
I think that's the best because that covers everybody and it saves precious time. So thank you, thank you, thank you, everyone. The recommendations over here, that is again a very difficult job. But I request everybody who is present in this room, and some people who have been lost to call, to write to us what they think should be the recommendation of this workshop. Because if I try to attend, there are so many things that I definitely make a big mistake. I may leave out some critical recommendations that have been made. So what I would like to suggest is my personal request to each one of you. Aap sabhi logon ki taraf se kam ek recommendation hamare mail mein zarur aana chahiye. So please write, as a minimum, please feel free to write whatever you think should be the recommendation of this sammelan. And I promise that within, say, 10 days time, I compile all those recommendations and send an email to everybody. Okay, that is what we do. The third thing we would do is that all the rapporteurs who have done such a wonderful job of taking notes, all those reports we will put together in the form of a booklet and include the recommendations that you would give to us. Put it together as those reports and a summary of the recommendations that have come, you know, from this summary. Is that all right? So the reports from the rapporteurs, and then we have a set of recommendations which each one of you will write to me. That I think would be, it should kind of try to, we'll try to sum it up in whatever best way possible. Is that all right? Okay. So the only thing I would like to say lastly is that, before I make some announcements, is that I think this, personally, I was able to see this was a very beautiful confluence of thought leaders and practitioners. This is what I realized in this seminar, and we need both of them. We need thought leaders and we need practitioners. And we need both of them to meet with each other and take it forward. It shouldn't be a lab to land fiasco. It should be something that comes from somebody's mind. It should also be something that is being experienced by someone, and then both things come beautifully. And something very beautiful and something very nice and progressive emerges out of this summit. So I think that is all we have to say.
I would like to thank all of you for your presence and listening. All the sessions of this Sammelan, I think, were best so far and very interesting. And there were, I think, nobody was feeling bored and everybody was engaged in this session. So I would like to thank all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Now some announcements, and but there are some people who need, you know, who needed to be thanked, because it's really important for us to recognize and appreciate the work that they are doing. Thank you. But before that, some announcements. One is that EDAA has created something called EDAA Adda, and all these deliberations, etc., they are there available. So please do visit. Then I was told by Venu that on Manch also she will be having lots of information, and she'll be starting some webinars, etc., and she'll try to tackle some of the questions which could not be answered in various sessions. So they will try to address it there. And then another announcement is about the reimbursements that is available in room number 316. Room number 316, as you go out, you have to step down, and then those rooms are on the right hand side. And once you go to room number 316 and collect your reimbursement compendium and your pen drive. So a copy of the compendium is also being given to everyone. And then after that, we all go down to the parking for something called community lunch, which is not in atrium today. It is in the parking, thanks to the meeting of the election commission, which is happening right now. So we all go down to the parking, where our team has made arrangements for everybody to have some packed lunch, where we can have some get together kind of thing. So these were the announcements that I actually wanted to say, and really, अभी नहीं भाई, अभी खत्म नहीं हुआ. Ansari, जब तक कि मैं आपको नमस्कार न कह दूँ, आपको बैठना है.
अभी और अनाउंसमेंट है बैठना.
So एक ही बस एक ही चीज कहना चाहती हूँ कि बाकी तो सभी लोगों को हमने थैंक यू कह दिया, क्योंकि इतने सारे लोगों को थैंक यू कहना हमारे लिए पॉसिबल नहीं एक एक आदमी को लेकर के. लेकिन एक जो टीम है जिसे थैंक यू कहना बहुत जरूरी है, और वो है वन वर्ड की टीम. तो बिग थैंक यू टू राजीव एंड हिज एंटायर टीम. सो रियली बहुत मेहनत से और बहुत मशक्कत से उन्होंने ये काम किया, एंड दे हैव अरेंज्ड ऑल दीस थिंग्स इन अ वेरी शॉर्ट पीरियड ऑफ टाइम, इन स्पाइट ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट द क्लियरेंसेस सैंक्शंस एवरीथिंग केम वेरी लेट. आई थिंक दिस टाइम दे रियली मेड वंडरफुल अरेंजमेंट्स, एंड थैंक यू वंस अगेन टू ऑल. दैट्स ऑल. आई वुड स्टॉप विद द थैंक यू, क्योंकि अभी और किसी को थैंक यू बोला तो फिर प्रॉब्लम होगा. सो आई एम स्टॉपिंग विद विद दैट. I think I have finished whatever I wanted to say.
Yes. What is more important is that this time we will also have some regional sammelans. We have decided to have at least 4 regional sammelans this time. So that is the plan. So that, you know, and maybe we will try to see whether you could bring some community members also, because those would be smaller groups, and see whether we could have a bit more engaging discussion and conversation with those people. I would like to mention that. What else should I say? Once again, thank you to everybody. And thank you, Suman, you have come all the way from Nepal, I must say that. And thank you to all agencies, all organizations, Vigyan Bhavan and our interpreters, definitely. Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much for being with us, and thank you for all your love. Your love, that is very, very important. All your love and support. Namaskar. Ab Ansari aap ur sakte hain. Group number 316.
Lekin Ansari urne se pehle sabhi log 2000 taliyan MIB ke liye. Thank you. There's a feedback form that I've given to everyone.